So everybody's talking about the coronavirus right now, and a lot of people are getting freaked out about it. And I know in the eye clinic, almost every day I'm having patients ask me what I think about the coronavirus outbreak. So in this video, I'm gonna go over how I feel about the whole coronavirus thing, as well as sharing some little known information about how the coronavirus could potentially spread and even infect the eye. Let's take a look. Hello everyone, this is Dr. Allen here from the Dr. Eye Health Show, helping you learn all about the eyes and vision. And today we're going to take a little bit of a change in direction. We're going to talk about current events, specifically about the coronavirus, the Wuhan virus, or now known as the COVID-19 virus. And just to start off, letting you know, as a healthcare professional, I do take this very seriously. I'm personally not freaking out about it like some people are, but I think that it's, as a healthcare professional, knowing that people are getting sick and people are even dying from this disease, I do take it very seriously. Now, if you've been paying attention to the news, you've been hearing about the coronavirus, which started off in China, East Asia, and is now actually spreading a little bit more throughout the world. Now, thankfully, we have a new name for it. It's called the COVID-19 virus. Personally, I'm not a big fan of that name. I like to go by symbols and different things like that. And honestly, we've been talking about the coronavirus for the last 2 months, so I think it's probably gonna continue to be called the coronavirus. Now, although I've been taking the coronavirus thing very seriously, I am personally not worried about it or really that anxious about the whole situation at all. Partly because when I was in school, we had to deal with the whole Ebola thing and what ultimately happened with that. And with what's going on right now, being that the entire kind of global community is paying attention to it, we have government agencies and healthcare agencies like the CDC and the World Health Organization working to kind of identify what's going on, who's getting infected, and really kind of taking the best steps to identify it and work on it, makes me just feel better about the whole thing in general. On top of that, of the cases that have been reported, about 80% of the people only experience mild symptoms. And the people who are eventually going on to having lethal effects and dying from it are people who already have other illnesses or are in really weak immune states. And that holds true with pretty much any virus. In fact, the current influenza virus is still a more major concern because of how widespread it is and currently still kills almost like 38,000 people a year here in the United States. I'm not exactly sure on that number, but it's pretty close. Now, the coronavirus symptoms or the COVID-19 symptoms are very similar to other types of viruses or colds. People usually experience fever, shortness of breath, and a cough. And this is the sort of question that we ask just about any patient who comes into the medical clinic anyway. What's important is that if I'm seeing a patient for a routine exam or if they're coming in from something like a pink eye infection, we ask these questions and then we follow up with an appropriate follow-up question, such as, hey, have you been in China or East Asia within the last 2 weeks or so? Or have you also been in contact with a person who has been ill and been in East Asia in the last few weeks? And those are very important questions, not just for me as a healthcare professional, because I'm in close contact with these individuals, but also for our community at large, because we don't want to spread this to everybody else. Now, in terms of how the coronavirus spreads, it spreads very similarly to every other type of virus, whether it be influenza or just the common cold. And that's when we cough or sneeze and little air droplets that are infected kind of get carried over and it lands on somebody else's mouth or they breathe it in, and that's usually how a lot of these infections takes place. As well as these other bodily secretions that can land on hard objects and perhaps live for a short period of time. But thankfully, this specific COVID-19 virus isn't really believed to last very long on hard surfaces. Although with that in mind, it is still really good practice to clean and disinfect any sort of thing that people may have touched, particularly if people are not feeling well in the household. So I think if somebody is having problems with symptoms, cold-like symptoms, again, coronavirus or not, or just the common cold, make sure that you are disinfecting, cleaning doorknobs, any sort of cupboard handles, light switches, things like that. And of course, as always, make sure you're washing your hands. And one little known and interesting fact that people really don't talk about is how viruses can actually be spread and potentially infect the eye. And that is because these infected little water droplets that pass through the air can land on the surface of the eye, and your tears and the conjunctiva, the gelatinous-like surface of the eye, is a possible way of transmission of that virus into your body. And that's one of the reasons why in hospitals you will see doctors wearing eye protection during procedures or working with people who are very sick. And that's again because bodily fluids and even coughs and sneezes that get onto the surface of the eye could penetrate into the body. And that's why if you are a healthcare professional working with people who are ill or just living at home, it is best to try not to touch around your mouth, your nose, or your eyes, because those mucous membranes could get infected. Now, as an eye care professional, I've actually gotten notices about how these sort of viruses, specifically the coronavirus, could potentially affect the eye and even cause a conjunctivitis, also known as a pink eye. And although most people think of pink eye as being a bacteria, most cases are caused by viruses, again, similar to the common cold and influenza. Now, I personally have not read any cases specifically of this COVID-19 coronavirus causing pink eye. However, theoretically, based on what we know about viruses, it is certainly possible that it could get into the eye and potentially even pass from one person to the other through the tears. And that's exactly why pink eye in general is so virulent and spreads through schools and things like that very fast, because when you have the virus on the eye and then you touch your tears, you get all that watery secretion, you touch something like a door handle, and then the next person touches that door handle and they rub their eye and it passes from one to the next. Interestingly enough, even viruses like HIV can be found in the tears. And that is exactly why in the eye clinic, whenever we have a person who has HIV, we have to pay attention to what touches their eye so we can super deep clean everything. That way it reduces the chance of it spreading. And although with the knowledge that yes, things like HIV can be in the tears, there has been zero cases ever reported of HIV passing from one person's eye to the next and infecting somebody. But with this knowledge of how viruses are shed in the tears is exactly why we are so incredibly just absolute bacteria neat freaks when it comes to the eye clinic. I mean, we deep clean every room after every patient, whether they have pink eye or not, but if somebody does have a red eye or an infection, we pull out some really nasty chemicals to clean everything. I mean, this is stuff that you don't want on your skin. We have to put on gloves and things like that and everything. And I'm enough of a germaphobe that if I do have a patient with an infection, I'm basically paying attention to every single little thing I touched from the moment I came in the room, including what pens I touched, what part of the keyboard I touched, what part of the chair, everything. Again, when it comes to any type of an outbreak of any new disease, the media goes crazy with it. And I encourage you to make sure that although it's important to pay attention to what's going on with current events, it's important to also pay attention to what the authority is that's making those statements. So if you have a friend or just somebody out there who's been tweeting a lot about different articles or news releases about these kind of coronavirus outbreaks, make sure that it's not something that's causing you anxiety. A lot of times it's being blown out of proportion. And if there is an important thing that's changing, you will hear about it from the CDC or the World Health Organization. Otherwise, what I've been recommending all of my patients to do is just the typical normal things you'd have during any flu season. And that is to wash your hands frequently. Again, if you're sneezing or coughing, make sure to not use your hands. Try to use the sleeve of your shirt, for example. Again, try not to touch your face, specifically around your mouth, nose, or your eyes. Again, make sure you're cleaning off cupboards and hard surfaces that are commonly used, especially if someone else in the house isn't feeling well. And if you are feeling a little under the weather, it's better for you to just stay at home, take a day off of work, and rest, because just Mother Nature letting you rest is gonna usually help you feel a lot better and get over that faster, and it's gonna reduce your chances of spreading that to other people at work and things like that. But as always, if you are feeling really sick, make sure that you are reaching out to a medical provider in your area so that you can be taken care of. Hey, thanks for watching. If you enjoyed this video, smash that like button for me. Otherwise, keep an eye on it, and we'll talk to you soon.